Hey everyone, Coach Powers here. I want to talk to you just really quickly about a benzo epidemic documentary that I'm going to be producing later this year. Well, we're going to start it later this year. I think the film or the documentary will probably take about a year to complete. And I really want to dive deep into what's going on. And I'm thinking about titling it The Benzodemic. You know, like the benzo epidemic. Boom. Combine both of those words, the benzodemic, because that's what I see is happening here. And I really want to talk to a lot of psychologists, psychiatrists, you know, different medical doctors, big pharma, politicians. I mean, I really want to dive deep into this thing and get these people in the hot seat and ask them the hard questions and find out why there are more protocol and regulation and enforcement of these protocols and regulations for people coming off benzos. I mean, wouldn't it be nice to get your doctor in a chair and not allow him to weasel his way out or gaslight? And just actually have to answer the question, sir, did you know that benzos, let's say the Xanax I was on for 3 years, did you have any inclination that coming off of it could somehow put me in this disability and put my life in jeopardy? And if you say no, I'm going to say, well, boom, what's this, Dave? Dave has a big yellow envelope filled with APA and AMA peer-reviewed research that states that, yes, indeed, benzos are very dangerous. I mean, see, that's the thing, folks. This isn't a conspiracy. It's not just a bunch of people angry at their doctors making up things. This is a real phenomenon, and they've known about this for 50, 60 years. I mean, there's nothing new here. We know that benzos are very addictive. We know they're very dependent building. We know they have an atrocious list of withdrawal symptoms, side effects. We know people kill themselves every year coming off this drug, right? So we have to attack, maybe not attack is the right word, but we need to approach this with the science and get those doctors to say, acknowledge this, right? Now, I don't know if they're just gaslighting us because they don't care or they're trying to save their own asses here. I suspect that's probably what it is. They're trying to save their own butts here. Went in wrong. You know, when you're wrong, just don't acknowledge it. You know, it's easier just to say, it's probably your pre-existing condition. You know, metallic taste, yeah, that's a pre-existing condition. Night terrors, you know, akathisia, pre-existing condition, right? You had that before benzos. So, and I'm trying not to become irrational on this topic, but the longer I've worked in this field, this area, the more passionate I've become. And it hasn't gone the other way. You know, having gone through this and coming out of it, it's almost like you escape from Alcatraz and you don't want to go back to Alcatraz under any circumstance, even to prosecute bad correctional officers. You're just like, hey, I escaped. You just want to run the other way and never come back. And eventually it did come back. And I did start working here and trying to help other people that were kind of falsely imprisoned, right? And now, after seeing so much, hearing so many stories from you guys, I mean, the image in my mind now, I mean, so many, I'm literally maybe 1,000 or more stories of different doctors, from the gaslighting, from, you know, just getting angry and ripping people off meds, to throwing them on different dangerous meds, to blaming them, to if they disagree with the doctor, they're not compliant, you know, I've heard it all. I mean, I've heard it all, and I've heard things that, in a perfect world, many, if not most of us, would have a class action lawsuit. You know, but maybe that is something that comes down the road, right? What I would like to fight for in this documentary is just to say, hey, America, here is a problem. You probably know a lot of these people, and they're not talking because they've been gaslighted, and this is what they're going through, and this is what it looks like, and this is what their doctors are saying, and this is what clinical psychologists are saying, this is what neuropsychologists or, you know, neurologists are saying, this is what big pharma says about it, you know. And here's what politicians are saying. How do we change this? What does change look like, and how do we change it? Well, for me, in my perspective, change begins with informed consent. You know, well, maybe change begins with first getting the doctors to admit there's a damn problem. That, you know, mental health isn't as simple as going, take this pill. Take this pill. You're better. Because that's how life works, right? You're grieving. You have an anxiety disorder, panic, trauma. Take this pill. That's as easy as it is to cure life problems. I mean, God. But to just get the doctors to admit that there's a problem here, that these miracle pills have side effects and that they have profound dependency, and people coming off them can be injured for years, you know, just to get them to admit that. And then we want to fight for protocol changes, you know, informed consent to say, hey, client, you know, hey, patient, you're having test anxiety, you're going through a tough time, you're stressed at work, you have trouble sleeping, here's a pill, but be careful, this pill could, you know, could ruin your life one day. Now, it's on the rarer side, many people come off it, they do okay. I would argue that, you know, this notion that, oh, people just come off it after long-term use and they're fine, that's a bunch of crap. That's just lies, that's just not true. You know, anyone that's been on a benzo for a year, I don't care who you are, 99.9% of them are gonna have some pretty strong withdrawal symptoms. Now, true, they're not all gonna be disabled and all that, I get that. But the other fact here is that doctors, they deal with the symptoms by, the withdrawal symptoms by just, here's a couple more, you know, here's some gabapentin, here's an SSRI, here's, you know, insert other meds to kind of try to round off the bottom a bit. And then when that doesn't work, just blame their pre-existing condition again. I mean, it's a wonderful cycle and a wonderful little operation they have going there in that regard. And again, not every psychiatrist is like this. There's wonderful psychiatrists that are completely rational and lucid on this topic. And I don't mean to single them out, and I don't even mean to come at psychiatry in some negative way, because I don't think that's the solution here, is to create this us versus them. But there is definitely a phenomenon here that needs to be addressed. And you know, I often say it's like you buy a car and you drive off the lot. You know, you pay all this money, you drive off the lot, you get 5 miles up the road, suddenly both tires fall off, the axle falls off, you wreck into a tree and almost die. And you come back to the car lot and you say, hey man, I got 5 miles up the road and the damn axles came off. And the car got, you know, the guy that sold you, the car salesman goes, yeah, that sometimes happens. We're familiar with that. We forgot to tell you. It's on the rare side, but it does happen. I mean, even with cars, when there's something like that, you get a factory recall. They offer to pay you. There's oftentimes you can sue the company. I mean, there's class action lawsuits, but at the very least, they, you know, once they're aware of it, maybe they weren't aware of it initially, okay, fine. But it's a little bit different with cars, right? Because they can manufacture a car and it might take a year before they really get the reports and go, oh wow, after a million of these cars on the road, you know, 10,000 at least, 15, 20,000 have come back with the front end, you know, the right side wheel just falling off, right? So, okay, now we know about that, we're gonna address this. With psychiatry, they already knew this prior to all this. This was not something that we needed to wait to see the data to come in. They knew the benzos were very dependent building. They knew the risk of altering GABA and a psychotropic med in the brain. You know, they knew these things. So we need to get them to be accountable. And I think, just like we saw with the opioid crisis, we need to first alert everybody in America and around the world that there is a phenomenon here. We need to get the doctors to admit it, and we need to back it up with science. And then we need to approach Big Pharma and some politicians and say, here's the phenomenon. What do we do about this, guys? And Big Pharma may come back and say, listen, we told the doctors, we did our studies, we told them it's highly dependent building. It's a controlled substance. What do you want us to do? You know, maybe they say that, and maybe there's some truth to that, that Big Pharma could say, look, we just created a med, you know, benzos in themselves, when used the right way, can be amazing, could be life-saving. You know, we didn't tell doctors to go and prescribe them every day for years and misprescribe them and rip people off. That's not we have nothing to do with that. That may be Big Pharma's position. I suspect they're still with lobbying, and there's still a lot of dirt and dark stuff that needs to be addressed, even with Big Pharma in regards to the bigger picture of benzos. But okay, and if that's the case, that they can say, we informed your doctors about that, fair enough. Let me take that piece of evidence, come back to the doctor and say, well, Big Pharma said that they did inform you and that they did give you studies and that you were well aware. And then we check with the AMA, the American Medical Association, and your university, your curriculum in psychotropic education, right there. It's in the textbooks. You were taught this. Big Pharma informed you of this. And nobody believes that out of all your clients, this is a rare occurrence to you, that you just, you know, because that's what I hear from a lot of my clients is that, you know, well, my doctor said that he's never seen anything like this. It's, not true. I have a psychiatrist in my family. I had family that worked as a secretary at that office, you know, at my uncle's office. And I asked them flat out, how many people did you see, you know, come in for anything, get on a benzo and just come off? And they said, I've never seen it. It doesn't happen. Not without hell, you know, not without hell. It's very rare. They try to get off. They all go through the situation. They get more meds or they end up back on the on their benzo, usually on a higher dose or a new benzo altogether. I mean, even me, when I went to the psychiatrist and talked to him about it with my situation, you know, when I was dependent on Valium, he said, yep, sometimes benzos just stop working, you know, certain ones. Let's switch you over to Xanax. That was his whole thing. And here's some Seroquel. Xanax and Seroquel. That was his reaction to me wanting to come off. Anyway, I'm starting to ramble on a little bit here. But anyway, I'm very passionate about doing this documentary. And in my life, you know, I don't really, I'm not looking to make benzos the rest of my life. Like I'm an artist. I want to work in, you know, I'm going to be working in mental health. I already work in mental health, but as in private practice as a clinical psychologist, and filmmaker. Like I don't want to make benzos my whole life from here out. And so almost what I've been doing is trying to just fight the good fight and say, here's a bunch of videos as I see it from my background, my experiences of how I helped myself heal, how I helped my clients heal. Here's how, here's a book or two on it. Here is some coaching. Here is, you know, one thing I'm working on over the summer is like a 60-hour online training course for benzo recovery. Boom, here's that. Here's a film that you can show your friends and family and get your own validation, you know, have your experience with benzos validated and help raise awareness. And then boom, here's a documentary. And then after that, you know, I doubt I will be doing too much more in the benzo community. As sure as I say that, I end up on like a damn TED talk or before Congress or something. I don't know. But I'm just saying that the goal isn't to make this my whole future. I just really look at it as like I stumbled upon this problem, you know, in mental health in America, and I just want to do my part and the most I can to give everything I can to this thing before I transition out of it. If it goes that way, who knows? As soon as you're out, they pull you back in, right? But God, wouldn't it be nice to raise awareness, get these doctors accountable, get some laws changed, you know, even if it is just to get doctors to really provide informed consent and be transparent. Because, I mean, raise your hand that if you had went to whatever your reason was getting on a benzo, if your doctor had said to you at all remotely informed you on what you could have been going through, what you're going through right now, or what you had gone through coming off benzos, would you have still taken the benzo? And I would guess at least 50% to 85% of us would say, nah, I wouldn't have. I would have tried talk therapy more, yoga or something. No, wouldn't have done it. Maybe I would even try an SSRI before, you know, getting on a benzo long term again. No, I wouldn't. So we need that. We need that freedom of choice, right? We need to be able to do that and not just be told it's okay. Don't worry about it. Take it as long as you want. You won't have a problem. We'll get you off in 2 days. 30 years on benzos, 2 weeks, you're off. Don't worry. You'll be right back to normal. It's just ludicrous, bizarro, and it's criminal. It really should be criminal. So anyway, that said, I'm going to be working on that later this year. I've got a great agent, casting agent and a producer signed on already. We're looking at maybe getting an A-list celebrity to be the narrator of this documentary. We're toying with the name Eric Roberts. I think that is a very likely possibility. I mean, I know it's a possibility. So we might be reaching out to him. I love Eric Roberts. Grew up watching his movies. I just think he's a great person. But there's a few other people we're looking at. I want someone that's really passionate about it, that not just looking to like virtue signal through a cause, you know, to get their name out there and say, oh, I'm so-and-so and I'm associated with PETA or this or that. But to have someone say, hey, I want to do this because my mom or I went through this or somebody I loved went through this. I'm sympathetic to this or empathetic to this. But to have a A-list celebrity, you know, that it draws eyes. It opens up so many things. Then you can reach out to other people like maybe Stevie Nicks or Eminem or other celebrities that have gone through this to get them to share their experience. And I know some of you go, well, screw these celebrities. Why? Who cares? It's about eyes. It's about their audience. You know, it's about reach and it's about impact, right? I mean, we won't make it the documentary won't be about celebrities at all, but to just have somebody with a big following and a big presence is going to get more people watching it, and it's going to help get this on Hulu, Amazon Prime, not YouTube, of course, but Netflix, things like that. You know, then they go, oh, you got so-and-so on it. Oh, you got Eric Roberts associated. Wow. Okay. Now I'm listening, you know. It's going to help the project. So I hope some of you are excited about that. As sure as I say that, I know there's a couple people going, you don't need celebrities. What is he doing? But we do, guys. We kind of do. I mean, if you really want impact, you do. Okay, so that's where we are. Exciting. Very cool. Can't wait to get started on that. We're going to be doing a GoFundMe for that, because that's going to be way more ambitious than what we just did with this feature film. I mean, that's going to require traveling, flying, whatever, to all around the United States. You know, I want to be working with people who are coming off benzos at different phases, you know, people that are just starting their taper, people that are deep in their taper, people that are post-taper. And I want to, over a period of a year, show America and the world, look at this person, look where they started, and look what they went through to come off of it. Look at their trials, hear their stories, see their tears, feel their pain, hear their stories about their doctors, look at their ripple effect on their family. You know, look at how they lost things and their careers and marriages, and, you know, there's a destruction in the wake of this thing. I want that to be in America's living room. And that's the goal of this, you know. So I'll be looking for people that want to participate, and you guys can help me. I mean, I hope you can help me with this, not just with funding and everything, because I hate to go, hey, please help me with money, but to say, do you know good doctors? Do you know bad doctors? Do you know scientists or research people? Do you want to be part of this? Would you be someone that might want to be interviewed and say, yeah, I have things to say. Come talk to me, you know. Help me put this together, guys, and we could, you know, together make a real change here, I think. All right, guys, thank you so much. More content on the way. I don't want to let myself down myself.